My name's Sam, founder of Kasada. I'm background in breaking things, but the more interesting people who are working in fraud day to day are next to me. So Brigette, can you introduce yourself quickly?
This is Sam, yeah. Brigette Korney, I'm the director of payments and fraud at Groupon. Groupon, double-sided marketplace. We've had a lot of different iterations of our business, but we sell everything from a deal for a local merchant on, you know, down the block, to tickets for a big venue, travel deals, all different things. So we have to have a platform that can adhere and be flexible to all different revenue streams and business lines. But been there for 13 years. I like to say I am a piece of furniture around there, which is great. I've gotten to see the business grow and change in a lot of different ways and lead to a bunch of different experiences. So hopefully we can add some more here. There.
Hello. Hi, everyone. My name is Shelby Vignes. I'm the Director of Internal Controls and Fraud Prevention at Arbonne. Arbonne is a health and beauty, skincare and wellness organization focused on sustainable, healthy living. We are a certified B Corporation, so anything we do has a sustainability focus and lens. I've been at Arbonne for a little over 3 years and positively elated to be here with you today.
Thank you, guys. Well, look, user experience and fraud or friction, I guess, always a fun tension that exists between the business, how much loss we're willing to accept, how much we're willing to piss off our users, all the good stuff. So I'm really curious to hear from you guys. So at the moment, given that there's been an enormous boost in both like e-commerce volumes from legitimate consumers and then fraudsters over the last few years, what are the biggest challenges you guys are facing in your businesses at the moment?
I'm going to go first. So I think it's kind of twofold. You mentioned both sides of it. It's the fraud attacks that have kind of changed and shifted over the past year, 2 years. I think we kind of we went through waves over the past 10 years where maybe one type of fraud was really relevant, and ATO or friendly fraud or whatever. And I think right now we're kind of seeing everything being really relevant. Fraudsters are just using technology that we all use as well, but they're just really ahead of us and very sophisticated. I think there's that side of it. And so we're trying to do our best and be flexible and adapt. But then right now, I think given the macroeconomic conditions, we're also trying to fight the side with the business, right? How do you make this as seamless as possible? How do you automate as much as possible? How do you reconsider maybe your strategy of manual review? Is that part of your strategy? Do you want it to be for the next five to 10 months? How do you shift and change, and what is the right balance there, while also being cost conscious? I think is the third pillar that we need to consider when we're really changing and shifting strategy.
Yeah. Our biggest challenge really is, I don't like to say fraud protection and risk management along the customer journey is a balance, because that assumes one part is as equally important as the other. And so like I really prefer to refer to it as a dance. Like throughout the year, there are gonna be different types of priorities. And so shifting what that strategy looks like, depending on what the circumstances really are. So for me, our biggest challenge is how do we put a revenue focused lens on fraud protection? Like what are we really achieving when we are doing manual reviews, when we are mitigating some of that risk, when we push back on those legitimate customers? It's really just to foster protection for the merchant, but really continuing to focus on the customer as well. So for me, it's the dance of fraud protection and at what point of the year we're in and what is our biggest priority and how do my fraud protection initiatives and my strategies really contribute to the collective merchant's model and vision for that 12 months, 18 months, insert time frame here.
I love the dance. I feel like we should have called the session instead of, you know, the
sometimes
dance.
It's a salsa, sometimes it's a waltz. Like, I don't know.
We could go on.
Right,
it, yeah.
Sometimes it's just like slow mo. I don't know. Like it really just depends. And then, of course, with fraud prevention, no one has a crystal ball. I think that's probably why I love fraud prevention so much. Is I am always on my toes. Like, I am always maybe surprised a little bit on what types of
no
tactics
day is the same.
Yeah, no tactics are the same, and very cyclical.
How frequently do the business stakeholders, I guess, at your companies actually backflip on, right? We want more friction because we're not happy with these losses versus let everything through. We want to make more money.
Am I allowed to say hourly? I joke, but I kind of mean that. I think it's, especially for a company like Groupon where we're selling so many different types of things, and you guys have a huge skew, I think that changes with each of those types of things. Some things we're more willing to be less risk averse on. We want to push through as much as possible. Don't interfere at all because maybe you're looking at different parts of the cost there, like margins and whatever. And I also think it depends on the leader. You know, how educated are they on what the platform looks like? What are the capabilities of the platform? That is a continuing, talk about cyclical, constant conversation, right? This is most of my sales counterparts, at least, and even marketing counterparts, have no clue what fraud is. They hear fraud and they're like,
Why are you talking about this?
Yeah. Did Chase Bank text you that you get a phone call that you have fraud on your account? Like that's what they understand. And so how do you like relate what your platform can do and what it can enable for them and unlock for them in a way that is relevant, but also gets your point across and also gets you what you need. So I think it's just a constant, like I am having a conversation about it at least multiple times a day, every day.
Really similar for me, but what I'm really fortunate to have is a really powerful communication network between my leaders. So communicating up, I'm in the finance org. I like to say I'm in IT. Anyway, depends. But really, like the communication between all of my executives is really powerful. They all have a deep understanding of what it means to manage risk in the organization. And so, as I said, it's very cyclical. There are certain times of year where we want as much conversion as possible, irrespective of what risk that really brings to us. Sometimes the reward is greater than the risk. And so, but for me, I think the dialogue is very clear. Sometimes you have to go deep in the weeds. And so I do get that response of like, why are you even talking to me right now? And fortunately, I really enjoy being in the weeds, but not all executives do. And so pulling out the narrative out of the weeds, transitioning a data set into a story is really the essence of how to be an effective fraud leader and manage the risk like holistically across that journey. But again, my constant question is, why are you talking to me? And it's really because this results in ultra conversions, extra conversions. So that's at least been the lens lately.
Now the user journey and I guess acquisition is going to look very different for all sorts of businesses, right? If you're selling, you know, high volume, low value products, mid or sort of low volume, high value. I'd be curious for you guys, what does the average user journey look like for you? And what is a challenge that you have with that, with like making a fraud decision if you know you don't get much interaction or whatever it may be?
I don't want to keep going first if you want to. I'm happy to.
So the most successful customer journey for me is absence of them knowing that there's a fraud evaluation even taking place. The goal is that they don't even know that they appear risky or not. The less declines that they can get, I choose to absorb some of that risk internally and operationally. It does drive a specific skill set of analysts and people who know how to look and put context clues together to drive the most informed decision. But for me, the customer journey is absence of knowledge that any sort of fraud evaluation is taking place and the limited amount of errors. So during those reviews, the goal is for you to make as few errors as possible and make that cumbersome for our customers. So really being prepared to make the wrong decision, be prepared to be wrong, and have a process ready and in place and a dialogue ready for those customers to be really satisfied for when you do make the wrong call for that fraud protection decision.
I think also I completely agree with everything that that you're bringing up. I think the other part of it too is that the journey for us doesn't just start at the buy button, right? It really is so far upstream. How did they get to Groupon.com? Did they come through a partner? Was there something there collecting all of that data? Did they create an account collecting all of that data? Did they log into their account, kind of using all of these different parts of the journey to then effectively make a decision that is invisible to the customer? And all these pieces, right, they don't see. We all know that this data is being collected about us, but I don't think the average consumer does. Or maybe they do now with the TikTok stuff, but that's a whole other topic. So I think thinking about it more holistically and not just about what is specifically in front of you and in your control kind of goes back to some of these other parts of the conversation we've been having, that it's not just directing up your communication and education, but it's also outwards to the people that do own those other parts of the funnel and making sure that they understand that we need that data to be good and clean as much as possible so that we can make this, we can have that ultra conversion. We can say that, like, this can be effective.
Right, and, you know, from a fraud protection standpoint, like, we're not the ones interacting with the customer, and so it's really essential to make sure you have those very strong relationships with customer care, with your marketing and sales teams. Who is interacting with the customer? Who's training the customer on what are the best practices throughout that customer journey to make it as streamlined as possible? Not everything is intuitive. You can make your website and your login process and your account creation process only as intuitive as your customer understands it. And so making sure the people who are talking to your customers the most have a very clear picture of the balance and that customer journey, as well as the dance, not a balance. The dance of how do we mitigate some of that risk? How do we really collect enough information to make the most informed decision for our customer? That's been really beneficial for me. Taking the things that I have learned from the fraud protection space and repurposing that and communicating that to care and my marketing teams and my sales teams, so that's always a lens. That's always a reminder. All of these best practices are really essential for the most positive customer experience for us.
Shelby, I like your comment about when things go wrong, what to do, because we're not perfect, and a part of the customer experience is when we make a mistake, how do we make sure it's causes as little pain for them as possible. So what have you guys seen change in the last sort of 12 to 18 months? You mentioned, you know, friendly fraud and ATO are all the rage. Like, what have been the big shifts for you both?
I think it's just all of them at once, right? Like, that's like, you know, just constantly being hammered with even more sophisticated techniques. And I think my team specifically has spent a large part of the pandemic focused on creating an efficient and as automated as possible platform. Groupon supports small merchants, and obviously those small merchants were closed for a large portion of the pandemic. So we had we capitalized on having the time and the resources that weren't maybe focused on other things for now, right? Like, this is what we were expecting to happen, is that when things opened back up, we expected a huge influx of fraud, and that could have gone wrong, right? Like, we could have wasted all of that time and effort to just rip it out and do something completely different. But it's paying off now that we've focused on being flexible and focused on adapting and making those right decisions.
What's been the focus for us is the strategy has to be important. So while I can't predict the future, you kind of know what pocket is going to be risky next. And so not only is understanding your customer journey really important, understanding the pitfalls of your strategy collectively, focusing on the payment button, focusing on that risk evaluation after you've collected payment is one thing, and solidifying that, but really being in the forefront and anticipating what could be next. So everything that I have anticipated would happen has happened. Not that I can see into the future, but it's really important to understand those pitfalls in your strategy collectively. You can't address everything at once. So you focus on the part that's bleeding, or the part that's the most challenging, the part that requires the most IT dev work or the most changes from the product side. But anticipating what other pitfalls are going to take place is what's really essential for me. And that's essentially what's been happening. So focus on the payment, and somewhere along that journey, it's happening just as anticipated. And so making sure you have those relationships to alleviate that risk has been part of what I've seen recently.
So on strategy, how do you manage, all right, things are on fire, we need to deal with something that's going on now, with actually, no, we need to plan for the future, because the reality is their behavior is going to change. And if we are just like playing whack-a-mole, we're never going to catch up. How do you do that yourselves, and also like justify to the business, hey, this is what we're going to invest in longer term fraud strategy versus this is what we're going to do today to solve, you know, the fires?
I think it all ties back to what is your business, like, what is Groupon's corporate priorities, right? Like, that helps drive then the decisions that I'm making. I don't want to say both. You have to do both, but you do. Like, you kind of have to have resources devoted. And maybe it's 80% of the resources are doing the fire, you know, putting out the fires, and 20% at that time are doing KTLO. But communicating, like, if we don't do that KTLO in 6 months, this, our model or X, Y, and Z, whatever thing is going to happen, what is the pitfall of our strategy right now? This is what's going to happen, and communicating that. And then if that's the decision, if that's in line with the corporate strategy, that's kind of what's making my decision or helping me make that decision. All kind of ties down, it trickles down. I think that also helps when I'm leading my teams, because they can then see you're working on X, Y, and Z, because that translates into how you're impacting the larger corporate strategy. This is how you're adding benefit to the company. And so that's been effective for me and how I make strategic decisions, because I think then it also ties, like I said, into overall leadership principles.
I ask them, like, when do I need to get on the table and jump around and start shouting, and what thresholds are you acceptable with? And so part of that starts with a sincere, just educational part of, you know, fraud protection, payments. It's such a niche area. Like, not everyone's an expert in all of that transactional flow. And so starting from an educational standpoint and then challenging them to give me feedback on when do I need to say the building is burning down? And so that's been really rewarding for me of, wait until we get here, then you contact me. Otherwise, we're on a strict need-to-know basis. For me, I like to be on a need-to-know basis. For fraud, I want to be invisible. I don't want anyone to ask me what's going on. I don't want anyone to ask me what we're losing. I will communicate that upwards, but that has required that educational balance between my finance leaders, my technology leaders, getting them up to speed on what's really going on first, and then asking them to ingest the information and tell me when do they believe it's not acceptable, and then make sure your communication plan for when that threshold happens, it will happen, it will, make sure that that is ready and targeted and pointed and anticipating solutions. So that's what I've been doing. Yeah.
Lots of fun. Yeah. So this has been, you know, some theoretical chats, stories. I assume, you know, we can maybe anonymize a little bit and pretend we don't work for the companies we work for. One thing that I guess stands out to you when you think about the last 12 months, one like fraud campaign or specific attack, what would that be?
I think the attractiveness of things that weren't attractive before. And I mean fraud attractiveness. So, obviously, like, a gift card is going to be fraud attractive. It's easily resellable. But I think we've started specifically to see maybe trusted payment methods that we always saw less fraud on. Now we're seeing a lot more fraud on. I'm not going to name any names, but that's one like the unexpected is happening. I don't want to.
I'm fortunate to work for an organization that has really, really wonderful and incredible products. And so fortunately for us, but unfortunately from the fraud space, it would be really easy to resell on some sort of dark party. I don't even know. In some illegitimate means. And so for me, what we've really seen is focusing on the things that you don't anticipate or you think no one really wants to steal, but it's really like kind of a distraction. So using short-term items, purchasing short items during a short time and really distracting me while some other things are going on. And so when that pocket is really happening, wondering where or else the risk is taking place, that's at least something I've started to see. And a lot of our transactions that are coming through is a lot of the things that were not popular before are now being purchased, but I don't think that they have a lot of leverage in any dark market that they're being sold on. And so, but I know that there's some other hidden risk that's taking place at the same time. So it's like a very sincere distraction in how it's being managed at this point.
Makes me think of like the flip side too that we've seen is things that are super fraud attractive when they don't have a fraud spike on it. You're like, oh, that
Why
means they're gearing up for, they've got something else, right, that they're going to gear up. And so where is... where's the hole? Like that means they know that there's a hole in our fraud checks or whatever it might be in our model. What are they going to capitalize on? And so knowing like that's going to also come is unexpected in a different way.
The cycles of fraud that I've experienced are pretty consistent. I mean, it's extremely cyclical and heavily time-based, at least from our experience. Of like, there are certain times of the year where I can anticipate to be drowning for a period of time. And then there are other times of year where it's just low-key and I can work on my strategy and I can work on how I address those high loss times. It's extremely cyclical, but learning from the past is that cycle really stands. Maybe I give or take 30 days, but it's still within that whatever quarter, that 3 to 4 month time frame that you just like kind of brace for impact.
Yeah, I love how it's either everything's on fire, and then it's like, but it's quiet now. But why is it quiet? This is suspicious. Come back so I can at least see you. It's also really interesting how they sometimes are better at figuring out what is valuable than a lot of companies are, right? They, you know, safe payment methods has been like something that we have seen go through the roof, right? Any e-commerce website that lets you save a credit card, all of a sudden, like, wait, that's just as valuable as a credit card, and it's a repeat customer.
And if you have any stored cash, like even... like we call it Groupon Bucks, right? Like stored value credit. Like that's now we maybe didn't see for a long time that being valuable, but we've seen a spike in those accounts being compromised because they know, you know, and then you partner with your network security teams and then you do your due diligence on the dark web and you see, oh, of course there is, because there's a list out there of Groupon, you know, accounts with stored value, you know, like that exists, right? They know which accounts have that on it or which accounts have certain payment methods stored because they know there's a change in their risk models or whatever it might be.
Like I love to make the joke, but moms always know and like the fraudsters always know too. Like they are watching everywhere, social media, Google, like everything. Like there's just like a very, very high level umbrella oversight of everything you could possibly think. They know what vendors you have. They know what partnerships you have. It doesn't take a long time to create an account. And so once you have an account, that's an end to many other relationships and partnerships that we as merchants have to have. And so they learn, they pick up on it, and they use that against you very quickly and very easily. And the pockets of cash, as you're saying, that's typically being targeted or starting to be more targeted than those products.
It's unregulated cash, right? That's the beauty of it.
Yep. And they know that merchants maybe look at it with less of scrutiny, right? Like there's a loss associated with that for us, but really it's more of a customer impact. Like it's not, we're not sending that call out to Visa or something and getting dinged on our, you know, what, like that I think is a bigger thing too, is that we should have known that was going to happen. But this is kind of goes back to what you were saying. Like we knew that was a pitfall in there, but like we had to make the decisions to either prioritize it or not.
It's not material enough at the time that like the dance of priorities is very serious. But
we've definitely seen these folks become more brazen and more people get into it because no one gets punished.
Right.
It's sort of like a wrist slap at worst instead of like, well, you know, just buy one of these stolen accounts for $5 and use the $500 stored on it. So on that idea of trying to figure out what's actually going to be difficult, how do you guys go about assessing your risks, like your gaps, and where people are going to come after you next?
Be the fraudster. Put your fraud hat on. Try to steal from yourself. I shouldn't say that, but pretend to steal from yourself. Like go through that entire process. Like log in. Do what you're asking your customers to do. Do what the fraudsters are trying to do. Always be thinking in the lens of how would I try to steal from myself now. That's what I typically do.
I think also having like a seat at the table for new initiatives, right? Like we try and roll out things all the time that are different, and they go to a test group or, you know, that relationship though that I have with our growth team or with our business development team, the partnerships that they're rolling out, having a seat at the table for like just a voice, not a stopper, not a blocker. And I like plead that to my team all the time of like, we are not here to stop the business, but we want to make them aware of the pitfalls of this new program that you're trying to roll out is. And if you're okay with those risks, you know, being completely upfront with them about that, tell us what that number is when you don't want us, when you want me to alert you that this is really bad. What's the amount of that we're okay with losing? But like that, like I said, that having that seat at the table and getting just a voice in there, making them aware.
But even speaking of voices, ask your customers. They will be happy to tell you how to make it better. Ingest that information and use that in your fraud protection strategy going forward. You know, for us, I've got very vocal customers, which I'm very, very happy to say that, really passionate customers. And so ingesting that information and using that as part of my risk management strategy is the only way you're successful. Keeping them happy, figuring out what they want and how that fits into the collective picture has been what's really, really good for us. Taking in that information, asking them, having forums, talking, having a dialogue, air your grievances, so to speak. What are all the things that you wish were better? And how can we, how can that come to light? And then how do we also protect ourselves and them at the same time? So the voice for sure, like having a voice at the table internally, but asking your customers to have a voice just the same.
So, Bridget, you mentioned before working with CorpSec when accounts get stolen, right?
Yeah.
How do you guys, within your companies, what is the, like, delineation between corporate security problems, fraud problems, and maybe, like, e-commerce's problems? How does that currently work?
It's unique for Groupon. I think we really kind of consider where the fraud happens. So that's really delineates it for us is, like, do we view a phishing attack or something, like where, what type of attack is, where is it coming in through? So is it on the merchant side? Is it a fraudulent merchant? So that would, you know, kind of go into that team. All of these teams have to kind of be in sync and understand how they influence each other. And like I said, have like those conversations, but ultimately knowing that like the decisions that we have in our network security program and the model that we use there is going to influence the transactional risk, you know, my area and, you know, vice versa, that kind of stuff. So I think knowing where each team sits, but really like working together on it.
Yeah, so my responsibility is all types of fraud at Arbonne. So any kind of fraud that comes our way, it starts with me and then working on connecting with all of my colleagues or the owners of that particular relationship and working on fixing that. So, you know, it all starts with me and then working on that strategy and then soliciting, you know, getting IT involved, getting IT security involved, getting treasury, whatever have you, whatever area would be responsible for this pitfall or this particular relationship, but typically it starts with a funnel of me and then that information gets disseminated accordingly.
Now, when it comes to vendors, external partners, right, how do you guys make sure those relationships are as successful as possible for, you know, for both parties? Because it can always be
holding them accountable. Yeah. Knowing like what is being being a good partner, first of all, I want to like lead with that because I think that is super valuable. And there's certainly instances that I can think of that I know merchants are not good partners to their vendors. That's the core foundation of then being able to hold them accountable and knowing, speaking with data, speaking like using data to not just, I feel like you weren't giving us enough attention or whatever like arbitrary complaint you might have, using data to make that lodge that complaint and hold them accountable to what, you know, contractually is obligated or what you would expect from them. I have found more success in those things when you have that core partnership there already.
Pulling the human part of life in general, making that a large component of any vendor relationship, any third party. So like heavily emphasizing being human, like asking them about their family, asking them like having an account relationship, an account manager that you are close to. That for me, I've gotten a lot better feedback and management and support when I actually know them. And so working on the relationship first, like don't even talk about your problems, like talk about each other, work on what you like to do, what you do in your free time. Like for me, knowing my partners, knowing my account reps has been the most successful part and getting the response I need at the time frame I need it. So pulling the human part back into fraud protection of, I just want to be buds with my account rep. Like, I love my Signifyd rep. He's absolutely incredible, but I know him. I have a relationship with him. And so when the building's burning down, I'm going to get a quicker response because we have a, like, just a holistic, like, organic relationship first before it's business, before it becomes anything outside of talking to another person.
Yeah, people, people, people. It's amazing.
Yeah, it's like dating. Like, talk to them, ask them about themselves. Like, that has really been, that's been really, really fruitful for my experience. Yeah.
Well, we're meant to have a little bit more time for questions, but we yapped a little bit. I don't know how we want to do this, because I don't know if there's a mic I should pass around, but are there any... We've got time for probably like one or two questions from the audience, if there's any.
I think, are we standing in the way of drinks for the audience? Are they?
Maybe,
No, there's a keynote session after
okay,
this one.
Sorry, not
Rebecca
to jump the gun.
Minkoff is
there champagne
in the way
for
of
it or something?
So I have a question that's kind of maybe for the room, which is, I love the concept of having that threshold or fraud budget or risk budget, however you want to think about it, and kind of managing within that and then escalating upward when you're maybe hitting that ceiling or blowing through it maybe. Is that a concept that's widespread? Is that, do other people in the room think that way? Is that a thing? All right.
Any brave souls? It exists for us, like Shelby said, same thing, but it took a long time to get there. I think, unfortunately, for a lot of merchants, fraud was an afterthought, and it didn't until it was a problem. You might not have had that conversation. I think we're all getting better at that, but I think it really depends.
I can't emphasize enough, just like ask. Sometimes you won't get an answer. If you don't have a clear picture, if it is an afterthought, you won't get an answer. But continuing to ask until they get to a point where they deeply understand when the certain topic should be escalated. For me, I just kept asking until I got the right kind of feedback. And I'm not even saying this dollar amount, please email me. Like, it is not that simple, but rather you pick up on context clues from your leaders. They will tell you without telling you at what point you reach out.
Well, thank you, Shelby and Brigette. I hope this was interesting to everyone.
Thank you, guys. Thank you, Sam.
Thank you. Thank you.